हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज समीरन मेथी, सीनियर लेक्चरर इन कंप्यूटर इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट फ्रॉम प्रवीण पाटिल पॉलिटेक्निक। आई वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर द फाइनल चैप्टर ऑन डीसीसी। द टाइटल फॉर द सेम इज रेफरेंस मॉडल्स। एंड रिमेंबर स्टूडेंट्स, दिस चैप्टर विल कंप्राइज ऑफ टू वीडियोज। सो स्टार्टिंग विद द फर्स्ट वीडियो, दीज आर सम ऑफ द लर्निंग आउटकम्स, यू नो द लर्नर्स विल बी एबल टू अंडरस्टैंड what is encapsulation, OSI model, TCP/IP model, IP address and difference between version 4 and version 6. So firstly, what is encapsulation? Encapsulation is nothing but hidden from the outside world. That is the English definition of encapsulation. So hidden from the outside world in the sense, as far as networking is concerned, it is protected from the unsecured place like internet. So that is nothing but encapsulation. So in detail, encapsulation is the process of taking data from one protocol and translating it into another protocol so the data can continue across a network. So there are various protocols, like we have DHCP, then we have SMTP. These are certain rules that need to be followed by a system to communicate across a network. So taking data from one protocol and translating it into another protocol is nothing but encapsulation is all about. The process by which data is handled layer to layer through OSI model is referred to as data encapsulation. They are talking about some layers. Those layers have deep functioning, so those deep functioning will be dealt in the coming slides. So as shown in the figure, data layer 7, that is application layer, along with headers added at layer 7 is given to layer 6, the presentation layer. This layer adds its header and pass the whole package to the layer below. So what they are trying to convey is, this is the diagram of OSI model. So we have 7 layers in OSI model, P, D, N, T, S, P, A. So P stands for physical, D for data, N for network, and so on. So P, D, N, T, S, P, A. So what they were trying to convey is, at the sender side, encapsulation will take place, and at the receiver side, decapsulation will be taking place. So the packet will be starting from application layer. From application layer, it will be passed to presentation layer, from presentation to session, session to transport, and so on. This is the first point. The second point what they were trying to convey is, when application layer's packet will be transferred to presentation layer, a header will be appended. Fine. And when presentation data will be passed to session layer, one another additional header will be appended. In the sense, each and every layer will append its own header to it. That additional header has the address of the upcoming layer. For example, application layer has its data, fine, it will append a header to it and pass to presentation layer. Now presentation layer, along with the header of application and data, it will append its own header. That additional header contains the address of the next layer. I hope the point is clear. And one more point is, level N-1 is not aware of which part of encapsulated packet is data and which part is the header or trailer. For level N-1, the whole packet coming from level N is treated as one integral unit. Now what is level N and what is level N-1? For example, application is sending data to the presentation layer. So application layer being 7, it will be treated as N. Fine. And presentation layer will be treated as 6. Hence it becomes N-1. So application is N, and in that case presentation will be N-1. When presentation will be N, that is 6th layer. So the upcoming layer is 5th layer, that is session layer. So it becomes N-1. I hope the point is clear. In case of doubts, you could post a comment. No issues. Fine. And what they are trying to convey is, level N-1 is not aware of which part of encapsulated packet is data and which part is the header or trailer. So what they are trying to convey is, presentation will append its header and it will pass on to the session layer. Fine. So session layer won't come to know about the header that was appended by presentation layer, because that header as well as data will be treated as a single unit that will be enveloped, that will be hidden from session layer. So whichever header and data was sent from presentation to session, that will be treated as a single unit by session. So session will add its own header and it will pass to transport layer. So now that header as well as data that was transferred from session layer, that will be treated as a single unit by transport layer and it will append its own header. I hope the point is clear. Regarding OSI model, there are two types of communication: horizontal communication and vertical communication. As you can see, in case if the device A wants to convey to device B via its same protocol, that is application layer of A to application layer of B, then it is known as horizontal communication. I hope the point is clear. But application to presentation, presentation to session, this is vertical communication, which will be dealt in the upcoming slide. So as far as horizontal communication is concerned, it is the logical connection between the layers. There is no direct communication between them, only logically they connect to each other according to the requirement, and that is nothing but horizontal communication is all about. More or less, horizontal communication is communication between same layers across two devices is horizontal communication. I hope the point is clear. Regarding virtual communication, as you could see, application to presentation, presentation to session, and so on, this is nothing but vertical communication is all about. The network layer will communicate with data link layer, the data link layer will communicate with physical layer. This is what vertical communication is all about. Regarding OSI model, so OSI stands for Open System Interconnection, and it's a reference model developed by ISO, that is International Standard Organization, in 1984. This is a factual data. And OSI model logically groups the function and set rules. They have defined certain rules that need to be followed for effective data communication between two devices. The model consists of 7 functions, often referred to as layers. You could remember this OSI model with the help of mnemonic like PDNTSPA. PDNTSPA. So physical, data, network, transport, session, presentation, and application. Now, functions of each layer in OSI model. Firstly, physical layer, the lowest layer of the OSI model, that is layer 1, is referred to as physical layer. It deals with the mechanical and electrical specifications of the interface and transmission medium. I hope everyone knows what is a specification. For example, a mobile has 20 megapixel camera, its battery is this, its microprocessor is this, and so on. These are specifications, right? So specifications of any device is related to physical layer. Data link layer is the second layer, fine, and it has 2 sub layers, that is logical link layer and MAC, that is media access control. Logical link layer determines whether the communication is going to be connectionless or connection oriented. I hope everyone knows connectionless is a wireless connection and connection oriented is wired connection. So data link layer has this purpose, whether a communication will be dealt in connection oriented way or a connectionless way. And next we have medium access control. It is responsible for connection to physical medium. If you remember, physical is the first layer and data is the second layer. So to communicate between these two layers, we have MAC layer, which is an additional task supported by data link layer. Then we have network layer. The third layer is the OSI model, or is the network layer. It defines how packets of data are constructed. It is responsible for addressing messages and translating logical addresses and names into physical address, that means IP address to physical address. Remember students, a device has 2 types of address, IP address and a physical address, right? So it translation of IP to physical is done by network layer. Then we have transport layer. It is the fourth layer and it is responsible for packet creation. Those packets should be delivered error free and in sequence with no losses or duplications. So basically error functioning is being managed by transport layer. Session layer is the fifth layer. It establishes and maintains interaction between communication system. The session is over. Fine. We get such a message. So for every connection, we require a session. We require some bandwidth to be given to us. So that is nothing but a session is all about. So for two device to communicate, we require a session. So that particular session is being managed by session layer, and it performs name recognition, security, and all those stuff related to session. Regarding presentation layer, it serves as a translator layer of the OSI model. So whenever a translation is required, in case it could happen that the preceding layer does not understand whatever data is being sent by the succeeding layer. So in that scenario, translation has to be done. So that is being managed by presentation layer. Regarding application layer, it serves as a window for application to access network services by user. So application layer, this mobile you are seeing, or window or desktop you are seeing, this is being shown to us by the application layer. The main benefits of OSI model are, it helps us to understand the big picture of networking. It helps understand how hardware and software functions together. It makes troubleshooting easier. Regarding TCP/IP model, like OSI model, we have TCP/IP model as well that was developed by Department of Defense. And like OSI model has 7 layers, TCP/IP model has 4 layers. So this is the diagram of TCP/IP. For OSI, I gave you NINOMIC, PDNT, SPA. For TCP/IP, NITA will be your NINOMIC. That is network, internet, transport, and application layer. So the task performed by session, presentation, and application will be managed by application in case of TCP/IP model. Regarding in a similar manner, physical data link task will be managed by network layer in TCP/IP model. I hope the point is clear. Regarding address resolution protocol, now I gave a point that any device has logical address, that is IP address, as well as physical address. For example, the logical address of a PC will be 192.168.0.1, and that PC will be situated in Mumbai. So Mumbai is a physical location and 192.168 is a logical address. So it converts logical address to physical address. Simple. It converts internet protocol address to physical network address, right? So it functions in layer 2. Fine. And ARP provides the interface between IP addressing system used by IP and hardware address used by data link layer protocols. When IP constructs a packet, it is known as IP address of the system, that is packet's ultimate destination. The address may identify a computer connected to the local network or a system on another network. So what they are trying to convey is, in case if you want to have a look at this diagram, so IP address will be the input, ARP will be address resolution protocol that converts IP address to physical address or hardware address. Simple point, ARP. Fine. Regarding DHCP, there are certain situations where a network administrator has to assign various IPs to various systems connected to a network. For example, if there are 5 PCs, so 5 PCs should be given an IP address by the network administrator. For a small network, it is possible. But when there are huge number of systems, for example, 1,000, so it is not possible for an administrator to assign 1,000 IPs to every system. So in this scenario, we have DHCP, that is Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol, which provides automatic IP addresses to each of the devices connected to a system. We have a practical for the same, where I'll give you a demonstration how DHCP works. Fine. So these are some of the steps of DHCP. When a client detects it has connected to a DHCP server, it sends a DHCP discover request. So there are client and server. Server will assign IP addresses to clients. The router either receives the request or redirects to the appropriate DHCP server. If the server accepts the new client, it will send a DHCP offer message back to the client. The client returns a DHCP request message to the server, confirming that it will use the IP address. So what they are trying to convey is, first client will discover the server, server will offer an IP address to the client, and in case if he is comfortable with the IP address, it will request an IP address from the server, and accordingly, once it is confirmed, acknowledgement message will be sent from the server to the client that now that particular IP address which was given by DHCP server could be used by the client. So this was it regarding part 1. I'll soon upload part 2. Thank you very much. Take care. Bye.